Hello, I'm Itzhak Perlman. 40 years ago, when I was a young boy learning how to play the violin, I never imagined the day would come when I'd be able to get around in a machine like this. And who would have guessed that if Beethoven were alive today, he could be implanted with a device that might allow him to hear his own music, or that people who had trouble getting around in the real world could learn how to move by traveling in a virtual world. For the next hour, we're going to take you on a tour of the technologies of the future, because, ladies and gentlemen, the future is here.
Sometimes in science, discovery is not only a quest to conquer the unknown. Sometimes it is a more personal journey. For Tom Rees, it is a race against time.
You're trapped in your body, but more than that, it dramatically compromises one's ability to relate interpersonally.
Tom Rees used to be a man who lived in his body. He had a successful medical practice. He painted. He loved the outdoors. Then all that changed.
You're dealing with somebody and you're talking and they tell you something which is funny or something that brings joy to normal people, and your reaction is sort of a Frankensteinian mask. And that has a very profound impact on the way people respond to you.
At the age of 35, Rees was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, a progressive neurological disorder that affects between 500,000 and 1.5 million Americans. But Tom Rees was not about to give in to his illness without a fight.
I think when you have a big problem, it takes an obsession to overcome it. I guess I wanted to walk. I wanted to be like I was. I think the primary motivation for me is my family.
I guess it's the scientist in him, and you know, maybe it's the fact that he's in his mid-40s, and you know, he's not 60, he's not ready to retire. He's got you know, family with young kids and wants to continue his life.
As Rees began to try to solve the riddle of his illness, he experienced a well-known effect of Parkinson's disease. By following a pattern of objects like stairs, he could temporarily escape the halting gait so typical of Parkinson's, called akinesia.
And this was very determined to find out what was unique about stairs that allowed one to walk, that one was different from the rest of the environment. And I experimented with simulating stairs with objects, first large objects, then progressively smaller objects. And finally, it got down to the point where I could use pennies and dimes and tiny little marks on the floor to simulate objects, and that was having the same effect as the stairs.
Lucy, you're almost there.
Come on.
Like Lucy, the patient in the film Awakenings, frozen in space and time, Tom Rees was part of a phenomenon called kinesia paradoxa, paradoxical movement.
What's been stopping Lucy from crossing to the fountain?
Nothing.
Exactly. The visual field just stops. There's a void. There's no pattern, no visual rhythm, nothing to compel her to keep going.
So we're making something.
Exactly.
All right, Lucy.
It is a kind of trick the eye plays on the brain, allowing it to tap into a more primitive form of behavior. Only when the pattern was extended into space could the patient walk again.
I would love to shop at Safeway because they have the 12 by 12 inch linoleum tiles, and I could use that as a grid. And those kinds of environments are wonderful, but they're not universal.
Unable to sleep at night or walk without over-medicating himself with the Parkinson's drug L-DOPA, Rees became obsessed with finding a way to permanently extend those life-saving patterns.
So I've sort of taken on the Frankensteinian ethic, working in my garage in the wee hours of the morning, I'm trying to come up with various kinds of hardware which serve my needs. I don't have access to the most sophisticated engineering equipment, but you can get by.
If Reese's inventions lacked polish, they more than made up for it in sheer ingenuity.
These are simply two cards attached with foot hangers to tennis shoes, and by stepping over the card with the contralateral foot, there's always an object ahead of one to step over, and you can bring your shoes with you. Not too socially acceptable, but it does work.
But even if you could take these Rube Goldberg gadgets with you, the obvious question was, would anybody want to? Reese didn't give up, though.
I was looking for a way to transport and superimpose the cues onto the real world, so I could take my cards or objects and have them always available to me, not just in my home.
Reese had heard about some specially designed virtual reality glasses that allowed people to watch TV while they were mowing the lawn or playing golf. His search brought him to the place where those glasses had been designed, the Human Interface Technology Laboratory, a part of Seattle's Washington Technology Center.
So the way this device works is there's a television monitor, basically a TV, in the brow piece, small one, reflecting off of a lens here. And it's like a mirror. It's reflecting it back into the eye. And your brain is taking the image from your other eye that doesn't have that TV picture and combining it with that picture to give you a view of the world that has embedded in it a large screen television set.
The inventor of the VR glasses, Tom Furness, had also pioneered the virtual cockpit, probably the most fantastic helmet ever devised, to train F-15 pilots to perform in combat situations. But in peacetime, even stranger uses were being envisioned for this futuristic eyewear.
We look at technology, particularly virtual environments technology, as being a way of augmenting the world, augmenting reality for people who need some sort of augmentation. And we have gotten used to over the years wearing glasses and hearing aids, and this is just another step in that progression toward adapting the environment to ourselves.
I read about this product and I realized that one could superimpose imagery onto reality without obliterating reality, which is the important distinction. One could see the real world and one could affect it by putting the objects onto the ground in front of it oneself.
Could virtual reality be used to overcome akinesia, the frozen state that plagued so many Parkinson's patients like Tom Reese?
When one is akinetic, there's not just the lack of walking. There's a whole spillover effect of problems. One is stiff, one is feeling of being underwater, one's mental acuity seems to deteriorate.
When the VR sports glasses were modified, they simulated the effect called kinesia paradoxa, paradoxical movement. What Tom Reese saw when he put on the glasses was a series of moving objects projected infinitely into space.
When one walks with the cues, all that lifts and melts away. It's not just gaining the ability to walk, it's gaining these other spillover effects, which are very, very liberating.
Not only did the VR glasses get Tom Reese moving again, they had another, even more surprising effect.
This is an example of dyskinetic walking, uncontrolled motor motion. And this is a result of chronic use of L-DOPA. One develops a supersensitivity to the drug. And these glasses can have an impact on that.
Scientists are now looking at whether Reese's discovery may have important implications not just for Parkinson's patients, but for people with other kinds of movement disorders.
His experimentation has all been exploratory and experimental, and not from the perspective of, gee, here's how the brain works, and therefore I should do this. His insight was coming from his exploration of the phenomenon. So it's pleasantly surprising, if anything, that something new can come from outside the established domains that study these things normally. It's sort of like garage science, and it it's exciting.
These days, at 4 o'clock in the morning, that is still where you're likely to find Tom Rees.
Tinkering, experimenting, building new devices which will hopefully optimize the effect of visual cues, making them more transportable, playing with lenses, reading through the literature, and just trying to understand what's going on.
As his struggle with Parkinson's disease continues, so does Tom Rees's determination to overcome it.
This has taken a lot of my life already, and the more I can claim back, and the more I can remain mobile for a longer period of time, the bigger the dividend.